That's correct, yes.
I seem to be full of it right now.
Okay, so just a reminder, we're going linear algebra, and we're using Dirac notation. And in Dirac notation, we say that a given vector, if you will, comes in two flavors. There's ket A, which is written like this, and we represent it as a column of numbers representing its coefficients in a given basis. And then there's bra A, which is a row, and the numbers are the complex conjugates. And we define it that way because we want the inner product to be positive definite. We want the inner product of a vector with itself to be a positive number. And so to assure that, we have to complex conjugate the numbers because a complex number squared, in general, is still complex. But if you take z star z for some complex number, the result is real. And the basis vectors in this notation, the ith basis vector, we write as ket I, like that. And it shows up as a 1 in the ith spot and 0 in all of the other slots for some given basis. And meanwhile, the ith basis bra, as opposed to the ith basis ket, is a row, which has a 1 in the ith slot. And then, using that notation, then our original column, A1, A2, down through AN, is A1 times a column which has a 1 in the first slot, plus A2 times a column which has a 1 in the second slot, 0 everywhere else, A3 times a column which is 0 everywhere except the 1 in the third slot, and so forth. Or in other words, any vector can be written ket A as the sum of its components times the ith basis ket. And bra A can be written as a sum of the ith basis bra times AI star, because the complex conjugates appear in the slots of bra A written as a row. And that says that if I take alpha times some ket, if I want the bra corresponding to that ket, it's alpha star times the bra corresponding to A. So you have to remember that when you do what's called taking the adjoint, going from the ket to the bra, you have to complex conjugate the coefficient that you multiply by. Any questions? Okay, and the basis vectors are manifestly orthogonal here. If I take two basis vectors and multiply them together, and remember that what we're saying when we take an inner product, like say A, B here, is to write out the row corresponding to A bra, so those complex conjugate coefficients multiplied by a column consisting of the coefficients of B, the ket, B1, B2, ... down through Bn, so we would just take A1 star B1 plus A2 star B2 plus An star Bn, and so on and so on and so forth. With this notation, it's pretty much manifestly obvious that if you take the inner product of bra I with ket j, that you're going to get 0 unless I is equal to j, because if I dot a row with a column, then I multiply corresponding slots together and add. And if the 1 is in a different slot in the row than in the column, then you're going to get 0 when you add everybody together, because this 1 is going to pair up with a 0 over here, and the 1 in this one is going to pair up with a 0 over here. So in order for that not to happen, in order for the 1 in the row to pair up with the 1 in the column, I and J will have to be equal to one another. They'll have to be in the same slot. So we can say that our orthonormality of our basis vectors can be written as inner product of bra I and ket J is delta IJ, the Kronecker delta. because we can write any vector like this, well, in a given basis, we might express some vector and tell you what the coefficients are, but note that you can have an infinity of possible basis vectors. So we think of one particular basis, say with the space of arrows, the I hat and J hat, the unit vectors in the x and y direction, but there's an infinite number of bases because you can associate in the space of arrows unit vectors with any coordinate axes that you like. We might want to convert representations from one basis to another. And the key for doing that is to dot with J, so to speak. So as we finished up kind of last time, if we want to find A sub J, we dot with bra J. In other words, we take the inner product with bra J. And so that says inner product of J with A is inner product of J with some of the AI at I, like so. And then we use the fact that we can distribute sums for a vector space. So we can write this as the sum over I of the A sub I inner product of J with I. But the inner product of J with I is delta J I, right? So this is the sum over I of A I delta J I, or delta I J, it doesn't matter. They're invertible. The indices on the conic are there. And so this sum is equal to AJ. Yeah, AJ is the only person, only one that lives. So AJ is the inner product of J with A. Or in the original sum here, if we want to just rename it I again, we can say that A sub I is the inner product of bra I with our ket A. And again, this would allow us to, if we have some arbitrary basis, that in an arbitrary basis, those basis vectors may not have a 1 in the I slot. That was with respect to some particular basis we imagine starting with. We can expand our vector in any other basis by always dotting with the ith basis vector, so to speak. We did an example of that last time, 45-degree rotated version of x hat and y hat, a primed coordinate system. Okay. Any questions? Now, likewise, we could start with, I'll point out here, notice then that we can plug this back into our original expression, that A sub I is the inner product of A with ket I. And we can write then that any ket A is the sum over all basis vectors of ket I times the inner product of A with bra I, like that. Space of arrows, the vectors that you know and love in two dimensions, consider the unit vectors x hat and y hat. Yes?
Does it matter whether you write the inner product before or after i?
It doesn't, but we're going to always write it like this. Because you'll see why as we go along. We'll write it like this because that leaves the ka always on the far right over here. So later on, we're going to think of this as this object being applied to the ka, and this object is therefore the identity matrix, it turns out. This is the identity, because if I apply this to any ket, I get the same ket back. So we can think of this in two incarnations. It's the sum of ket I times the inner product of A with I, but it's also this operator right here applied to A. So it's useful to adopt this convention of always writing in this order like this. So, suppose I have some vector A. A has components A sub x and A sub y. So A is x hat times A sub x plus y hat times A sub y. How can I write A sub x as an inner product? A sub x is A dot what? X what? X hat, yeah. A sub x is A dot x hat, because that'll be magnitude of A, magnitude of x hat, times the cosine of the angle between them, right? And so that's A cosine theta, that's exactly what I want for A sub x. So this is x hat times x hat dot A plus, how can I write A sub y as a dot product? A sub x is A dotted with x hat. A sub y is A dotted with y hat. So A is x hat times x hat dot A plus y hat times y hat dot A. This expression is just Dirac notation for this expression. In other words, here I said A is x hat times x hat dot A plus y hat times y hat dot A. That's an identity. Any vector can be written as that sum. And in Dirac notation, the vector A is represented as a cat. And we could consider x hat to be unit vector number one, if we like. And then in Dirac notation, the inner product of two vectors is written as one of these suckers. So this is unit vector 1, namely x hat, times the inner product of unit vector 1 with our vector A, in other words, the inner product of A with bra 1. A dot x hat in Dirac notation, if we call x hat unit vector 1, is this inner product right here, A projected onto 1, plus, if we let y hat be unit vector 2, then A dot y is unit vector 2's inner product with ket A. So this is, in the space of arrows, this Dirac notation corresponds to writing a sum like this, that any vector can be written as basis vector multiplied by the projection of the vector in question onto that basis vector. So any vector is a sum of its projections onto the basis vectors multiplied by the basis vectors. That's what this is saying. A is its projection onto x hat times x hat plus its projection onto y hat times y hat. Or in general, in any two-dimensional vector space, A is its projection onto the first unit vector times the first unit vector plus its projection onto the second unit vector times the second unit vector. That's Dirac notation for this expression in the space of arrows. Or in general, if I'm in an n-dimensional space, I have one such term for every basis vector, every unit orthonormal basis vector. Any vector is a sum of its projections onto each basis vector times that basis vector, add them up, and that gives you the vector back again. So that's an important identity, gets a box around it, be able to interpret it in terms of what you would write in terms of the vectors you're familiar with. You know, you've seen notation like this before. Dirac notation is an alternative notation for something you've seen before, but we're generalizing it to general elements of vector spaces and not just things that can be represented as sums of x hat and y hat and so forth. And notice too that this works no matter what my basis is. In other words, if I pick some new basis, which has been rotated with respect to the first basis, so now I have a new pair of basis vectors, which I'll just call generically 1 and 2, it's still going to be true that any vector is its projection along the first one times the first one, plus its projection along the second one times the second one. It's always any vector is A dot the first unit vector times the first unit vector plus A dot the second unit vector times the second unit vector plus other terms if we're in more than two dimensions. So at first, this looks like a ridiculously long-winded way to write out an expression for A, but it has content here because these are generic unit vectors here. Put another way, I think of the vectors as living in the plane and having an independent existence, and this represents how you write out the vector with some particular choice of coordinate system, some particular choice of directions along which to point the unit vectors. But it works for any choice, and so this is a perfectly generic expression. This too is a perfectly generic expression that works in any basis whatsoever. So you think of the vector as this abstract thing that has an independent existence, independent of the particular basis with respect to which you resolve it into components. The components are basis dependent. The vector itself lives on its own, independent of how you resolve it into components. Okay? Any questions? So there must be a raw version of this, an adjoint version of this, and there certainly is. Likewise, we can start with bra A. It is the sum of all the basis bras times the AI star. And again, AI star could be written out in front of it, but we adopt the convention of writing factors that multiply bras to their right, whereas we have factors that multiply kets written to their left. Here, we would dot with ket j instead of with bra j like we did before. And again, using orthogonality, orthonormality of the basis vectors, equal to the inner product of A with I in that order. So bra A dot ket I. And that damn well better be true, because remember that it was an axiom of our inner product that if I reverse the order of the vectors participating in the inner product, then that better be the complex conjugate of when you write it in the other direction. So that works out. It's nice and consistent. So notice our two versions, that ket A is the sum of IIA, as it were, right? Ket I bra I ket A. So inner product of bra I with ket A times ket I. And you can almost imagine taking this and flipping it around, and other than the fact that would make the sign be over here, okay. Ignore that little detail. You flip it around and you get the bra version of the same thing. Ignoring the sum refuses to participate in this silliness. But all the other symbols are happy to flip around like that. And so there's a reason, right? Yes, you could pull this over there if you wanted to. But it makes sense to be consistent, because then we have this nice flippy quality of when we reverse orders and so forth. So it's useful to adopt the convention that essentially you do it like that. The thing that you're expanding always shows up on the far left if it's a bra, or on the far right if it's a ket. Going from ket to bra, or vice versa, is known as taking the adjoint and those of you familiar with linear algebra will find that we're going to represent operators as matrices. And the adjoint of a matrix that represents an operator is in fact going to be the complex conjugate of the transpose matrix. So this is all going to be consistent with linear algebra that you may have learned. It's known as taking the adjoint. And from what we've done so far, we haven't brought in operators yet. From what we've done so far, we can deduce that the rule for taking the adjoint is, I'll read it and then I'll write it, conjugate all explicit numerical coefficients, and if a product of bras and kets is encountered, reverse the order of the factors and replace each bra with the corresponding ket, and vice versa. Got that? No? Okay, that's why I'm going to write it. From what we've done so far, we can deduce that the rule taking the adjoint is, I'll write over here because I'm running out of room, conjugate, by which I mean take the complex conjugate, conjugate all explicit numerical coefficients, example we've already seen. In other words, e.g., we saw that the bra corresponding to alpha A corresponds, I'm sorry, the ket, yeah, the bra corresponding to alpha A is bra A times alpha star. So that's saying that rule that we deduced, that if you have alpha times a column, remember that we want the bra to be its adjoint, its complex transpose, the row whose coefficients are the complex conjugates. So alpha ket A's adjoint is bra A alpha star, and the comma, and if a product of bras and kets is encountered, reverse the order of the factors and replace each bra with the corresponding ket and vice versa. It's a lot of words, but it's really simple to do. So I'll let the pencils catch up here. So those of you who have done linear algebra, we knew that you have it. What's the symbol you use for the adjoint? It's through a knife. That's the symbol for adjoint. It's dagger. Just thought of it as a little knife. Yeah. Right. So in the kind of thing we've been doing here, we would say that alpha A dagger, the adjoint of alpha ket A, is equal to reverse the order of the factors and replace kets with bras. So I replace ket A with bra A, reverse the order of the factors, so the coefficient goes on the other side, and I complex conjugate it. We've already said that. So alpha ket A dagger is bra A alpha star. So what about alpha plus in sums, I always want to be adding kets to kets and bras to bras. It doesn't make any sense to add bras to kets. So what if I want to take the adjoint of that expression? What do I do? For each term, I reverse the order of the factors and conjugate the coefficients. So the first term, I reverse the order of the factors. So that says I turn it into C as a ket, BA for the inner product, alpha star, plus, I kind of disobeyed my rules here because I wrote this on the other side of the D there. Okay, it's not a strict rule, so I'm just going to keep with it. Plus, bad me. I'm a bad person. Plus, times beta star, like that. But if I really wanted to be more consistent with what people like to do, I should have put the alpha over here. Oops, and I should have put the beta over there. But there's nothing wrong with this, so I'm still allowed to do that. It's just frowned upon. But it means the same thing. So bad me, but not super bad me. No points off, just a dirty look. So anyway, all right, so any questions? Yes? You're looking at me and ask a question.
Yeah. No, I mean, it makes sense, but usually is it okay if we just write inner product of A, B, into the stars? Because, I mean, when I think of inner product, I think of it as a...
Well, it certainly is true
that
I can do that, right? Yeah, I can certainly do that. But it would be preferred to flip the order like that. It's not wrong to just complex conjugate the inner product. But in the things we'll be doing later, you'll see that it's more useful to think of taking the adjoint as reversing the order. It's the same thing. When you reverse the order, you're taking the complex conjugate with an inner product. So not wrong, but similarly frowned upon. I shouldn't have done that. I should have put the alpha over here on the other side of this bra. Not wrong, but frowned upon. So, bad DH, angry face pointing at the alpha. I'm mad at myself for doing that. But I'm going to forgive myself just to point out that, you know, not wrong, but frowned upon. Any other questions? Okay. Let's see. So, now we're going to state, leaving proving for exercisey sorts of things, state without proof, two theorems which together assure us that if we have an n-dimensional space, we can always pick an orthonormal basis in that space. That it's not a special thing to have an orthonormal basis. We can always, given any basis, make various combinations of the vectors to produce an orthonormal basis. Theorem 5. Named after Graham and Schmidt, which is given n linearly independent vectors b1, b2, ... b(n), comma, by forming linear combinations of them, we can obtain n orthonormal vectors. And we'll call those 1, 2, ... And it's not unique. Given a set of n vectors, there's multiple ways you can do this. Helpful to look at a two-dimensional example of how you would proceed. Would you agree that these two vectors could form a basis for two-dimensional space of arrows, you know, the blackboard? Can I write any vector in the blackboard as a linear combination of those two vectors. Are they linearly independent of one another? They are, because you can't add them together and get zero unless you multiply them both by zero. And that's because they're not along the same direction. Linear independence in two dimensions means the two vectors are not along the same direction. So therefore, I can write any vector in the board as a combination of them by doing that parallelogram projection that we talked about before. You drop parallels to the other vector in order to find the projection along either one of these two vectors. So I can do that. Are those orthonormal to one another? They're certainly not, because they're not perpendicular to each other, and also they're not unit vectors either, right? So what can I do? Well, one thing I can do is I could start with vector 1 and normalize it. So I would just divide vector 1 by its own length. Take vector 1 and divide it by the square root of its dot product with itself, right? Because the dot product of a vector with itself is its length squared in the space of arrows. So if I divide by the square root of its inner product with itself, I now have one unit vector. And then, if I want a second unit vector, what I can do is to resolve vector 2 into components parallel and perpendicular to vector 1. And so let vector 1 unit vector be that arrow right there, which points in the same direction that vector 1 originally did. And then I can make, if I take vector 2 and subtract off its projection along vector 1, then all I've got left is its projection perpendicular to vector 1. So I can make v2 prime be v2 minus its projection along unit vector 1. And what that will give you is the component of v2 perpendicular to vector 1. I'm just doing this out of my head. I didn't do it in my notes. So if somebody catches me making a mistake, it's possible, then stop me. Yes?
You mean vector 1.
Oh, yeah, I certainly do. Yeah, thank you very much. Yes, I certainly do. Where am I going to put it? To the left or to the right? That wouldn't be wrong. But it would be frowned upon, because we like to make the order like so. We like angle brackets to be kissing one another, so to speak. That's kind of the rule, is angle brackets should kiss each other. It's not an official rule, but it's an effective rule, is that we would write it like. So thanks, that's right. Absolutely needed that, yeah, because it has to be a vector minus another vector. Yes?
I get into the habit of a number of times the vector.
That's because you haven't used Dirac notation before, right, or have you? Yeah, so in Dirac notation, we like angle brackets to kiss each other. We just do, okay? And the more you use it, the more it will be clear to you why we like angle brackets to be. So if they have a chance to do that, let them do it. And meanwhile, straight lines like to back into each other. So in other words, bras and cats, essentially, if they're faced, you know, they either like to be face-to-face or back-to-back. They don't like to be back-to-face. So if I put the one over here, then they would be this guy's face is looking at this guy's back, and they don't like that. So they either like to be back to back with each other, They either hate each other or love each other. Okay. So, so this is going to be that piece right there. It's going to be vector 2 minus its projection along vector 1 will be its projection perpendicular to vector 1. So now I'll have two vectors which are perpendicular to one another. But I want another orthonormal vector, so what do? I mean, another normal, yeah, just normalize vector 2. I just divide it by its length. So now 2 will define to be v2 prime over the square root of its inner product with itself, which turns into a mess when you throw in everybody else and expand it. But in other words, that's what you do. And you can generalize this to n dimensions. There's what's called the Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization procedure, where you generalize this to n dimensions. You start with one of the vectors and normalize it, then take another vector and subtract off its projection along the first vector, and you keep going, and after you've done that n times, you've managed to construct a set of vectors which are mutually perpendicular and they're all unit vectors. You can always do that. And this works just using the axioms. In other words, in the space of arrows, we've used our intuition about parallel and perpendicular, but in fact, it doesn't depend on that. All that you need are the axioms in order to generate a set of vectors whose inner products with one another are zero, unless they're themselves, in which case you get one. Okay, any questions? So, I can do that. I can take any set of n vectors that are Li and turn them into an orthonormal set. And then there's another theorem, which again we'll state without proof, but which is intuitively obvious in the space of arrows, which is that the maximum number of mutually orthogonal vectors in a space is the same as the maximum number of Li vectors in it. Or in other words, what it amounts to is if you have a three-dimensional space, by definition, you can have no more than 3 Li vectors in such a space. And because you can take 3 Li vectors and turn them into 3 orthonormal vectors, then in a three-dimensional space, you can have up to 3 mutually orthonormal vectors. And that's the content of this theorem, is that basically, put together, you've got, in an n-dimensional space, you can have at most n mutually orthonormal vectors to one another. Theorem 6. The maximum number of mutually orthogonal vectors in a space is equal to the maximum number of Li vectors in it. Space of arrows that says on the blackboard I can have at most 2 mutually perpendicular vectors. In 3 space it means I can construct at most 3 mutually perpendicular vectors. I can't add a fourth one in 3-dimensional space. thereby leading to endless frustration because I want to be able to visualize the four dimensions. Damn it, I can't. But I'll try to look at that. I have no choice. Okay, any questions? All right. Back to definitions. Subspaces, those are of interest in quantum mechanics because we talk about degeneracy in quantum mechanics. And so we want to talk about subspaces of a vector space. Subspace, on Star Trek, it's what they transmit their radio over, right? Subspace radio, whatever the hell that means. But it gets around the inconvenient fact that Starfleet headquarters isn't going to be able to contact the Enterprise in real time because of the finite speed of light, so they just send the signals through subspace, you know. But okay, but that's not what we mean by subspace here. Definition. What definition are we up to? I wouldn't remember either. It turns out to be definition 11 that we're up to here. Given any vector space, V, a subset of elements that form a vector space amongst themselves is called a subspace. We will denote a particular subspace I of dimensionality n sub I by v sub I super n I. So we will denote particular subspace I of dimensionality n sub I by that notation v subscript I superscript n sub I. Can anybody think of an example of a subspace? For example, take back to our familiar space of arrows. Give me an example of a subspace of three-dimensional space, a set of vectors such that those vectors within themselves satisfy all the vector space axioms. They have closure. Add two of them together, it's another one of those vectors. Multiply one by a scalar, it's another one of those vectors, and so on and so forth. So take three-dimensional space. Can anybody think of a subspace? About the xy plane. What about vectors that live in the xy plane? If I add two vectors in the xy plane together, were you going to say that? No guts, no glory if you're going to say that. Come on, you got to speak up. You got to go for the gusto there, right? So, two vectors in the xy plane. If I add them together, is that still in the xy plane? Sure is. If I multiply one by a scalar, is that still in the xy plane? Sure is. And since they're already vectors, by right of living in three-dimensional space, they satisfy all the other vector axioms as well, like distributivity of addition and associativity and all that kind of stuff. So the xy vectors that live in the xy plane are a subspace of vectors that live in three-dimensional space. Vectors that live in any plane are a subspace of the vectors that live in three-dimensional space. So those are examples of subspaces. What about vectors that lie along the x-axis? Is that a subspace? If I add two vectors along the x-axis, is it also a vector along the x-axis? Yes. Sure is. If I multiply a vector along the x-axis by a scalar, is it still along the x-axis? Sure is. So vectors along some line in general form a one-dimensional subspace, a three-dimensional space. Vectors that live in a plane are a two-dimensional subspace of the space of vectors that live in three dimensions. So you've met subspaces before. You like them. They're your buddies. Now we're going to make another definition. We're going to talk about adding subspaces together after the break.
Red button, yes?
Mm-hmm. Magic red button.